colleagues. I'm happy to share some of the insights on patient perspective on the mobile health. For this presentation, I don't have any disclosures. Well, thinking about mobile health, I have to say I see a huge potential. I see great opportunities for mobile health in healthcare by large and in congenital heart disease as well. So I have to say I'm relatively optimistic. However, at the same time, I also see some issues, some concerns that we may have, some problems that we are facing when developing mobile health and when adopting it. And these two perspectives I would like to share with you in the presentation of today. And about mobile health, a lot is to be said. Bottom line, we can say that mobile health is the application of wireless mobile technologies designed to improve health research, healthcare services, and health outcomes. It is argued that fitness, wellness, care provision, disease management, and complex case management can be supported by mHealth functionality, but the approach has to fit the condition. mHealth makes it possible to provide a more versatile and personalized approach to healthcare. And Deloitte did a huge survey, and they found that about 70% of the population represents a more active healthcare consumer, which has a strong preference to use online tools, mobile applications to locate providers and to compare treatment options and provider qualities. And if you hear about these 17%, you immediately would think, okay, they are talking about the youngsters, the young generations. The same survey from Deloitte found that it is 18% of the millennials that is categorized in this online and abroad group of people, the people with a preference to use mHealth. It was 19% of the Generation X, it was 15% of the baby boomers, and 14% of the seniors. So this means that don't think that mHealth is solely focused on the young people. Seniors are using it almost as much as the younger ones. And therefore, we also need to adapt the systems to this variety of generations. Why do I believe in mobile health? I think there is a huge potential for mobile health in terms of self-management. And when the question was earlier in this session on where can mobile health play a role in the Gooch, well, think about what Gerard Diller said about the upcoming group with heart failure, where medication adherence is so important. Well, in terms of self-management, there will be a critical role for it. I also believe in the strong impact that mHealth can have for empowering our patients and for increasing the patient engagement. This is a Facebook post that I read some weeks ago. It's one of my contacts who has a complex congenital heart disease. And it reads like this. So today, I was brought to tears by managing my complex medical condition. I have now spent almost 3 hours just trying to get some basic information from various providers. Online portals fail, help unavailable. Direct numbers for offices can only be found by clever Googling. Every call involves 6 levels of automated questions, following by a cutoff when your question is not on the list and you try just to get a person. I have not actually succeeded in getting one piece of information I need. I'm at the point of driving 20 minutes just to get one real person to get me on the result. The system is very broken. And on one hand, this says that in terms of accessibility, there is a problem. But at the same time, I was thinking like, if proper mHealth applications would be available, this could solve a part of the problem. But let's have a closer look on the different mHealth types. Again, Deloitte did great work in categorizing the applications according to four types of mHealth. And let's go through them. The first type is called the single-use mHealth. And this is a typical usage for a single person by a single user. It's quite often initiated by the person themselves, and it's for their own personal use. Sometimes it can be shared with other people. Examples of this are the well-known physical activity trackers, the Fitbits, in all shapes and formats we know. And other examples are the activity and health monitors that we all have on our smartphones. They are used for our own sake, for our own use. The second type of mHealth is the so-called social mHealth. Here, it pertains to support and encouragement through social networks. And gamification, this is a term that we heard during the discussion of the last presentation, gamification and competition-based apps that are encouraging the users. That is typical for this kind of mHealth. The consumers, therefore, are likely to pursue activities independently, but share it with others and come in a kind of competition. Examples here, or the first example is patients like me. And whereas patients like me started as a web portal where patients could find information on experiences and symptoms from patients like them, more recently, patients like me have developed an app where you can share your own symptoms, where you can share your own experiences, and doing so you can kind of benchmark your own situation with that of other people. And that may trigger you to adapt certain behaviors or to seek help if that is needed. Another example that you see on this picture is this older person who is using the Wii. You may be aware about the Wii heart failure study that is going on in Sweden and the Netherlands, where they are using the Wii to increase physical activities among older heart failure patients. Of course, here it is not about sharing the results, but the component of gamification plays a role here and is very motivating to the people. So, the third possibility, the third type, is the so-called integrated mHealth. And then I think we are at the stage where the previous presentation was about. Linking the app or the devices with the former healthcare situation, where patients can communicate with healthcare providers, where data from the patient in day-to-day life can be transferred to the patients, to the healthcare system as well. And indeed, in addition to the system that you just heard from Mark, it has to do with blood pressure, weighting, heart rate monitoring, and so on, and that is then transferred to the healthcare system. Or more and more hospitals are using an app or have developed an app where patients can consult their own medical records. The example that you see at the left here is from Kaiser Permanente in the US. So patients can really check their latest medical record, the latest reports, the latest radiograms that have been made, and so on. And then we come to the last type of mHealth, and that's the complex mHealth. And I believe that this is all about it. We need to go in that direction. Because here it is about a combination of different sources that are brought together, linked together, and then, of course, with a lot of predictive algorithms that can be used to kind of predict what will come. And it's understandable that we need a huge set of data mining techniques. If you are using data from medical records, from day-to-day monitoring, from symptom experiences, from activity measures, and so on. And if you combine that together with a good portion of artificial health, then I'm sure that we can make the next big step. Yeah. But we are not there yet, far from there. So let's have a look at what is known on the use of mHealth in congenital heart disease and what does it mean for patients. And first of all, and Mark already referred to that, the first thing is the willingness to use mHealth. And indeed, as far as I know, there are two surveys that have checked the willingness of using mHealth. One was an American and the other was the study of Mark where he referred to. In the American study, it was clear that 55% of the patients that were included were willing to use mHealth applications for the communication with their healthcare providers and for checking their own health. In the study of Mark, it was 75% that was willing to use mHealth applications. So yes, indeed, there is a willingness of our patients to adopt this. And once again, you would think that it is mainly the young persons that are going in this direction. Well, from a German study, as shown as here on this slide, the patients were asked what the sources of information were for them. Were it the doctors, was it family and friends, or was it internet? And here you see an increase of internet use going from child over adolescent to adult. So it were the adults who were using internet most to obtain information on their congenital heart disease. So, back to the literature. We are fortunate enough that this month a review article of Dirk Jan Kouw was published where different e-health applications and e-health studies in the literature has been described. So let's have a closer look at this publication. Overall, Dirk Jan found that 10 studies were published on the use of e-health publications, e-health applications in congenital heart disease. And these 10 studies pertained to 5 different technologies. And let's have a closer look at these. The first technology was the typically known home monitoring. It has to do with oxygen saturation, blood pressure, weighting, and predominantly in children after cardiac surgery. Overall, 5 out of the 10 studies pertained to this particular technology. The second technology was video conferencing, and again, this was focused on parents of children after cardiac surgery. So using the video conference, the parents could hook up with the healthcare providers, could ask questions if they were uncertain about specific issues. The review showed that 2 of the 10 publications had to do with video conferencing. The third mHealth option was the use of a portal, an informational portal, where people could go to and find some information. One study looked at this technology. The fourth technology was the use of text messages, SMS texting between healthcare provider and patients. One study. And finally, the use of mHealth, the use of a mobile phone and a specific app to encourage patients to engage in physical activities. And also here, one study. This review pertained to e-health, and that's of course broader than the mHealth that we are discussing here during this session. So if you look at real mHealth applications out of these 10, you can see that only 2 out of the 10 studies pertain to mHealth. And then let's look at this text message study. It was a study conducted in Canada. It was part of a bigger transition program evaluation study, and they were using SMS texting to engage patients in the clinical trial. And of course, they were evaluating the use of the texting in itself as well, and this paper pertains to that. What were the evaluations? First, two-thirds of the patients of these young people, adolescents with congenital heart disease, two-thirds preferred to be contacted and to communicate using texting. That's good to know. One quarter of the patients of these youngsters preferred to communicate by using email, and only a minority wanted to call the patients, wanted to call the providers, or wanted to be called. In this study, they also looked at the style of communication. Were the youngsters using slang? What kind of terminology were they using, etc.? That's beyond the current presentation. But what was interesting to know, although texting can go into two directions, it appeared that it was mainly the nurse who was contacting the patient and not the opposite way. So in terms of a real interaction, it's still a missed opportunity. The texting does not reach that goal. And then the other study, the study on the use of an application to engage people in physical activity. It was a study conducted in Denmark. And it was, as far as I know, the only randomized controlled trial on mHealth in congenital heart disease so far. And what was found? These investigators used VO2, max physical activity and quality of life as endpoints, and they did not find any difference between the intervention group and the control group. So to a certain extent, this is disappointing. On the other hand, the explanation for this finding is probably given on this slide. This is the proportion of patients that were really using the application. And you saw a decline over time. And of course, if people are not using it or not consistently use it, then we cannot expect any effect on the longer term. So when it comes to engaging, and that's also something that Gerard referred to in the discussion before this presentation, you need to engage people. It should be so exciting for people so that they continue to use the system. Okay, this was congenital heart disease, 10 studies. But what do we know from other conditions? Well, if you look at the effectiveness of mHealth, in 2018 alone, in the first 8 months of 2018, 11 systematic reviews and meta-analyses have been published. Not talking about all the systematic reviews and meta-analysis published before. So when you look in these different systematic reviews and meta-analysis, they all have a different angle, they all have a different focus, but they have a lot in common when it comes to the conclusions. Overall, they found that the content of mHealth applications is most often not based on an evidence base. So this means that developers make fancy applications because they think that it is nice to use or it is nice to look at, but not necessarily it's based on evidence and what is needed to be in an application. So this is something important to bear in mind. The existing studies, even if it is randomized controlled trials, but still the existing studies suffer from weaknesses in research design, lack of feedback, and clinical integration, and inadequate attention to privacy issues, something that was indicated before as well. The quality assessment revealed a high risk for bias in most, if not all, the studies. The investigation of usability is rare, and I come to that later on. And the data reporting of the effectiveness is limited, and therefore, currently, there is no hard evidence and there is a large uncertainty around the effectiveness of the interventions. There is one exception, and that's the exception of that's the condition of diabetes. A systematic review and meta-analysis showed that the use of smartphone technology was able to reduce the hemoglobin A1C in diabetes patients. So this is the only strong evidence that we have so far about the effectiveness of mHealth in healthcare. So what does that mean for us as clinicians and health services researchers? We need more, longer, and stronger studies evaluating the efficacy of mobile applications in order to optimize the outcome. And of course, a randomized controlled trial is the golden standard in this. But I also would argue that we need more usability studies. And usability is a typical methodology where the use of an application is evaluated on a very structured way. The one who is using it is monitored from different sites, even with eye tracker function, as you see here on this movie now. So you can see as an evaluator what are the parts of the app where the patient or the user is having problems to understand to work with it. Yeah. So once again, too often applications are used or developed from a developer's point of view and not enough from an end user's point of view. So what about mHealth that is in development? And you heard from Mark in his presentation the model that and the system that was developed in the Netherlands. In addition to the Dutch system, I'm aware about a system that is under development in Texas, one that is developed or under development in Canada, and one in Bern in Switzerland. I hope that in the upcoming years we will hear more about the system and how it works and what the impact of these systems are. So to come to the conclusion, as I said, I am positive, but I also have some concerns. Well, the great thing about mHealth is it has a huge potential, as I said, to improve self-management, to enhance empowerment, and to increase the patient engagement. It also can make healthcare more personalized and more person-centered. And the good thing as well is that mHealth has finally found its way to congenital heart disease. However, integrated and complex mHealth is most important and yet developed the least. There is very scant data on the effectiveness or on the usability of mHealth, and therefore there is a road ahead. The developers, they should use more usability research in the developmental process. Researchers should conduct more effectiveness studies to see if this is the system really contributing to optimizing outcomes. And clinicians, they should adopt systems that are in line with the perceived needs of the patients. Thank you very much.